This evening on The Rock Newman Show, I sit down with famed spoken word artist Taalam Acey. The poet discusses how he's using his platform to enrich audiences across the country, and he'll also share his thoughts on how poverty and education disparities in America have stunted Black youth. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. From coffee house stages to poetry slams and TED Talks, spoken word artist Taalam Acey's mission is to encode history for audiences of all kinds. Also an author and activist, Taalam joins me now to share how his passion for poetry has shaped his life and ways he's addressing homelessness and education inequalities affecting Black youth in America. Welcome to the show, Taalam. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
No, I saw in your in a TED talk that you did where you talked about your time at Rutgers.
Yeah.
Where you actually became an instructor, a teacher there.
Full-time accounting and finance instructor, yeah.
Full-time accounting and finance instructor.
At like 23.
At 23 years old.
About 23 years old.
How long did you do that?
I was only there for a year, but the thing was, they couldn't keep you but for so long because there was like an automatic tenure process. So, you know, if they kept you coming in, you know, year after year, eventually you'd end up with tenure. And they couldn't have me tenured because I didn't have a PhD. I was teaching after getting an MBA. And, you know, when you're trying to be accredited in these colleges, you need PhD, as many PhDs as possible.
Sure.
You know?
Sure. So you go through a process. I mean, your trajectory was one where you go through a process. You go to undergrad where you're, you know, your focus is on numbers and accounting and
my focus was on eating.
That's all college students. Look, I used to be a dorm counselor.
Right.
And I say two things.
You
did also?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I said there are two things about college students. It doesn't matter from which economic stratus they come from. College students are always hungry and always broke.
Right. And when I say eating, I mean, I didn't necessarily have to major in finance and accounting.
Yeah.
It just seemed like a good way to, you know, like a good major if I wanted to eat in the future. My grandmother used to say, you know, that I needed to focus on something that was going to pay the bills. So I thought maybe that would be it.
Okay, so you go through school and then you get your MBA.
Right.
Which obviously means you're sitting, you know, you're crunching numbers. This is a whole business thing, which is, as far from what you are now doing as any discipline could be. So here's my question. While you were doing that, did you have that internal yearning that, man, I'm walking down this street, but I really need to be on that one over there?
You know, at the time, no. I had been involved in poetry prior, so my poetry career was actually a return to poetry. I grew up off of it. My parents grew up in Amiri Baraka's organization.
Well, I wanted to ask you about that.
We'll get to that. Mm-hmm. My parents read County Cullen and Langston Hughes and Arna Bontemps. I mean, that, you know, well, my mother, you know, I was a single, my mother was a single mother, but you know, all of that stuff, I grew up off that stuff. You know, Langston Hughes were bedtime stories for me. So this was a return to it. At the time that I was doing the finance and accounting, I wasn't really thinking about doing poetry because I was trying to do what I thought responsible Black men should do, you know?
Uh-huh.
And the starving artist, you know, paradigm was something that I was trying to get away from at that time.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, you just said something. You said Langston Hughes.
Yeah.
was bedtime stories for you.
Yeah, the first poet to earn a living off of his work in America.
Mm-hmm. So here's my question.
Or the first black man to earn a living as a writer.
Right.
Full time.
Right, right. You may or may not know, there is a chain of restaurants here that is
Busboys and Poets.
Thought to be the most culturally diverse, and it's the owner, Andy Schlau, absolutely is in love with Langston Hughes and named it after him.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Malcolm X and Red Fox used to work at a chicken shack up up there. It's just, because Busboy goes back to Langston Hughes' background.
Yeah, sure.
So it's just funny that Malcolm X and Red Fox used to work together in a chicken shack in Harlem.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You know what? I never heard that.
Yeah. And they were working at that chicken shack at the same time that Ralph Ellison, it was either Ralph Ellison was writing Invisible Man or Richard Wright was writing Native Son. One of those two, whoever wrote in the post office, but one of those two things were happening in that same neighborhood,
Yeah. Okay. So mom was reading to you, you getting ready to go to bed.
Yeah.
And she was reading
Langston Hughes, the simple stories.
Sure.
You know?
And so as that was happening, you were hearing the spoken word. You were hearing the stories.
Yeah.
Do you remember how in your head you were bringing those pages to life? When you were hearing it, what were you envisioning?
I just saw it differently. My perception of what was going on was totally different than what was happening. So Claude McKay, like If We Must Die, it was different. She used to read Joel Rogers, who's a famous black historian, and he had a book called From Superman to Man, and I always had her reading it to me because I was kind of waiting for the point where he got to Clark Kent or something,
yeah.
But that wasn't what the book was about.
Mm-hmm.
So my perception as a child was different than what it became later on,
And so you did this, you got the MBA, you taught for a year. At what point?
I taught at Rutgers for a year. I taught at Essex County College, which was the community college, for maybe three years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And so at what point was it that you, and let me ask this, was it a point where you were like, I just gotta be through thine own self be true?
Yeah, after I taught for the year, I had a consulting firm, mm-hmm. So I had a consulting firm while I taught.
Mm-hmm.
So I started at Rutgers in their Small Business Development Center. There's one here in Howard as well in the business school.
Sure.
And from there, I started teaching full time. Uh-huh. But at the same time that I was teaching, I had my own consulting firm that worked with the SBA and the SBDC.
Mm-hmm.
And I moved that. We did commercials on television, all kinds of things,
okay.
for a couple of years. And uh-huh. that is the thing that started to feel not sexy enough. So uh-huh. I got in the spoken word when I was doing the consulting firm, and the money was fine, but the passion dissipated quick.
Uh-huh.
Money
was fine with this consulting and this responsible adult stuff you were doing.
Yeah.
But there wasn't the fire in the belly for it.
Right. Yeah.
And so when you came out of that and started doing spoken word.
And there was an overlap,
So you started doing it while you were doing that.
And then someone broke into the consulting firm and stole the computers, and it was just a transition period. It was like, what do I want to do now? Do I want to reinvest in this firm?
Yeah.
Or do I want to, do something different?
Yeah. What was the first poem? I kind of like myself. I think I know one poem in life, and that's a poem about Muhammad Ali. But what was the earliest poem that resonated with you that was your favorite?
I would say as a child, the If We Must Die poem resonated with me. In my later years, the poem that just never leaves my head, and it's a short poem, is Amiri Baraka's preface to a 20-volume suicide note. That just, for some reason, that poem just just moves me, and it's really short, you know, but yeah. It moves me.
And the first one as a child was?
If We Must Die. Claude McKay was a yeah. Jamaican poet. He was like the first lyrical poet. He's part of the Harlem Renaissance. Mm-hmm. And like Langston Hughes, he liked to recite his work sometimes to jazz. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't about just reading, you know, people mm-hmm. reading it. But he was the first one that's credited with just giving it the rhythm, you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah. Well, let me tell you something, man. I'm in preparing for this show, I really got excited, and I'm excited now. And part of what excites me is hearing stuff live. And so the Claude McKay poem, again, the name.
If We Must Die.
If We Must Die.
Yeah.
Do you remember it?
No.
You don't? Okay.
No.
All right. Now, what about the short one?
Amiri Baraka's. No, I've never taken the time to memorize anyone else's uh-huh. work other than my own.
Uh-huh. But it just touched you somewhere deep.
Yeah, it does. Yeah,
uh-huh.
It does. I mean, I can quote lines from it. He talks about walking in the streets to walk his dog at night.
Yeah.
And every time he walks his dog, he counts the stars in the sky. And when he comes out and the stars aren't there, he counts the holes that they leave. Uh-huh. And he came home and he heard his daughter talking to someone in the room. And when he went upstairs, he was disappointed to find that she wasn't talking to anyone, just her own clasped hands.
Uh-huh.
And it's really that short, so yeah, I mean that's a good paraphrase of it.
Yeah, yeah. You mentioned your Amiri Baraka, and we've had his son Roz here shortly after he became the mayor of Newark. Can you give us a little snapshot into what being involved in his workshop in his world meant to you?
Well, Raz and I grew up, we're contemporaries. In terms of Imamu, we call him Imamu Amiri Baraka. Imamu means teacher, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of Imamu, he's definitely not a contemporary of mine, sort of a father
sure.
for a lot of us.
Uh-huh.
Raz, as it turns out, used to run a poetry event in Newark, and it was one of the first poetry events that I attended when I first got into spoken word, him and a friend of his named Juba Daldell.
Mm-hmm.
So, he and I, you know, we've had that, you know, parallel camaraderie relationship, Raz and I. But in terms of Imamu, I spent a lot of my life thinking he didn't even know who I was, which is weird because I grew up in that household with a bunch of other children, right?
Yeah,
I was going to
say, in spite of the fact, I mean, I hear the rumor.
A lot of children.
I hear the rumor that the first steps you took as an infant
were in his house.
Was in his house.
Right. So uh-huh. when he passed away, it moved me that he wrote a critique of a poetry book. I didn't even see it until he was already transcended.
Yeah.
And he mentioned me. He was like, you know, how is this poetry book authentic and it doesn't have Taalam Acey in it? And I'm like, oh, I was wrong.
Uh-huh. he did know who I was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's get into something.
And not just me. He mentioned a lot of
sure,
people.
Sure, no, I understand.
But he mentioned me.
I understand. Because of the time that we're in, you know, early 2017 here, you have a poem called True Lies.
Right.
And we'd like to run that.
Okay.
There's nothing more romantic than fantasy, and we can make the war on terror distract them like videos and TV shows with scantily clad women, cover them with oil, rub it in like lotion, put F-16s in the skies and battleships in the ocean. The voters won't notice. Tell them you're either with us or you're against us, and in the same breath, over-vaccinate our soldiers. They'll want to believe these lies are the truth to the point that even Cynthia McKinney with proof won't be able to convince them that there's a connection between the war on terror and the Carlisle Group. They'll need to believe these lies are true. I said over-vaccinate our soldiers and coat their ammunition with radioactive DU. Fear is the final frontier of the defenseless. If it's logical, tell them it's senseless. You're either with us or you're against us. It's all about confusion. Name it the Patriot Act if it acts against the Constitution. One man, one vote is a joke. You should be more concerned about your family being broke. Poof. Mirrors. Smoke. Now watch me raise spending and lower taxes. The answer to any question that the 911 commission might ask is, we believe that stem cell research is immoral. North Korea has WMDs. Translation, time for Operation Iraqi Freedom. Sacrifice American lives on Baghdad soil. Earn more from our investments in defense and increase our supply of oil. The question is, how come we haven't done anything about the genocide in Darfur? The answer is, we believe in protecting the sanctity of marriage. Just give them a slogan. Let's roll. We're gonna smoke them out of their holes. Watch the hands Watch the hands. And this hand, Osama bin Laden. And this hand, the World Trade Center explodes now. I know you want me to get them for you, but the $200 billion question is, how much is it worth to you for me to allow my cronies' investments in defense to work for you? Don't worry about what we knew prior to the fact about the attacks. That's a distraction. Carol Ann, look away from the oil fields. The important thing to remember is that voting for my opponent will get you killed. There's a connection between his election and your family's demise. That's why African-American voters have to be disenfranchised. Neo-democracy means the electronic voting machine companies get to help us decide. That way you can win the election and still lose. That's the new world order. Global economy, no borders, no sovereignty, widow's cries, corporate plutocracy. True lies.
I started to say, I like what I do here and I get excited. And I got excited, man, about having the opportunity to spend an hour with you, and that's an example of why.
Thank you. I'm fortunate to be here, and I really appreciate being welcomed here.
Okay. First, I'd like to ask you, what was your inspiration for True Lies?
Oh, well, the Guerrilla News Network was a group of gentlemen who were working out of Berkeley, California, and they were putting together different political videos. Mm-hmm. And at the time, they had just done a video for Eminem called Mosh. Mm-hmm. Them and a guy named, I think, Haik Mubarak, I think is his name. He was the animator. Mm-hmm. And they got a Grammy for that, I think, you know. Mm-hmm. Well, the song got a Grammy. Uh-huh. I forgot what happened with the video, but it got an award.
Right.
They went and did this as well, you mm-hmm. know. They wrote a book called, it was called True Lies. Uh-huh. So I took what I knew and took things from the book, you know, based on what they had asked me to do, and put together the piece. And then they created the video with Haik, you know, uh-huh. after they did the one that we mentioned.
Okay.
And it was funny because then they put out a movie called American Blackout. They put the video in the movie, and I just remember wishing that I had known about that title, American Blackout, because uh-huh. I would probably have written an even more comprehensive poem to that title, you mm-hmm. know, because that resonates even more with me than True Lies. Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you construct a poem?
Well, it's really organic. I don't know the title when I start. Mm-hmm. All I know is the first line. And it's constantly asking, and I never know when it's over. Like, it ends when it wants to end, you know? And okay. then I come up with this line. The line just hits me. And it could take, I knew about Ayanna Monet, Stanley Jones, right, for many, many years before mm-hmm. I actually came up with the first line. Mm-hmm. And then once I come up with that first line,
yeah.
I'm asking, what does that line want to be followed by?
Uh-huh.
So there's a poem I have called Scars. It's like, I know where your scar, I can tell where your scars are yeah. just by the way you walk.
Uh-huh.
Came up with the first line. It took weeks to come up just with a line that I felt deserved to follow the first. And then that's the next question for every line. Does it deserve to follow the line that came before it?
Uh-huh.
You know, and you just keep going until the poem feels like it wants to end.
So
they're like real, organisms to me.
Uh-huh. So you come up with, I know where your scars are.
I know where your scars are.
By the way,
I can tell where your scars are just by the way you walk.
Okay. So you came up with that line.
Or it came to me.
Okay. It came, okay.
Right.
So it came to you. And so what you're saying is everything following that then is organic.
What should come next?
Uh-huh.
And you have to figure it out. So keep in mind, every day in, when I say it took weeks to come up yeah. with the next line, or maybe yeah. a week or so,
yeah.
every day or so, I came up with different possibilities.
Uh-huh.
But if I woke up the next morning and didn't remember what I had come up with, then it wasn't worth remembering.
Yeah. Yeah, but it didn't fit.
Right.
So on that particular one, can you do that one for us?
Sure. I can tell, I'm not going to look at you because it's a love poem and it would make me feel really weird.
I ain't mad at you. So look at this camera right here.
Good. I can tell where your scars are just by the way you walk. And every assault that you have endured has ensured your every step. And you are blessed regardless of the animals that have attacked you. And you are pure no matter who has abused you. I knew an angel when I see one. And when our kingdom come, it will be you, I and the Son, and we'll be one, we'll create children, and our children will create us. Then every night by the light of the moon, I will kiss away your scars to Abby Lincoln tunes. And I will drink perfume that tastes like you out of a vessel with a waist like you. Then I will draw our bathwater warm so we can soak until our souls are reborn. And you will be safe and secure in my arms, and it will always be this way. See, I can tell where your scars are just by the way you smile. And every night I walk a mile in your shoes, kiss away your tears and compile your blues till we choose to get sexy with Robert Johnson and Bessie Smith. And I will lick every bit from your soul's revelation to your pain's exodus. And when there's nothing left to sip, I'll massage the tension from your nakedness and then lift you in the most effortless way so you could just slowly ride all your pain away. See, I can tell where your scars are just by the way you moan. See, then the poem goes someplace.
You know you didn't want to look at me and made me want to kiss you, though.
Yeah, okay.
Man, that's phenomenal. That's phenomenal. And again, I'm going to repeat something. You know, having an opportunity to sit here in this chair is hearing stuff like this and doing stuff like this. It so makes me know that I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm going to ask you, I now know for certain that I'm going to ask you to do a few and maybe several more. Someone told me, a very wise guy, wise gentleman, told me at one point, one of the great values in life is knowing when to shut up. And having someone who does what you do, in terms of the message it sends, the entertainment that it brings, and the impact that it can have, I'm better shutting up. But I will talk a little bit.
That's a mutual feeling, because I find myself really wanting to listen to you when you speak. I see the wisdom, you know.
Okay. All right. So when you now have, you're spent a good amount of time on the East Coast.
Yeah.
You now have gone to La La Land.
You
out LA way.
Yeah, I'm in Los Angeles.
Why did you make that move?
You know, I have three biological children. My daughters, right? I saw my youngest daughter this morning. We went to breakfast in Philadelphia. I'll see my oldest biological daughter tonight when we have dinner. But my son, my oldest daughter is 21. My youngest daughter is 19. My son is 14, uh-huh. And he lives with me. Mm. But his mother lives in California.
Okay.
And I thought if I had the opportunity to move closer to her, she would, you know, they would spend more time together.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he tends to go over there on the weekends, for instance, you know, now.
Uh-huh.
But before, when before we moved to LA, we actually lived in Florida, mm-hmm. in Tampa. And he would only get to see her on the holidays. And I just thought it would be a better paradigm. You know, I had the opportunity to do some side consulting while I was out there in LA, you know. So it just was a good fit. But I'd say the main reason was so that he could have both parents. I mean, we're not together, but we're now in the same city, you know, in the same.
Okay. So LA. it wasn't something sort of drawn to the sun, or it was a place that was giving you a better vibe for what you are now practicing in terms of your spoken word, your creative side.
No. Spoken word wouldn't be places. I would give you eras. So in certain times, you talked about busboys and poets. Before that, busboys and poets was over there by 14th and U. There was Mangoes right there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in that time of Mangoes and Bar None and in Republic Gardens and all that, in that time, it was popping everywhere. In Chicago, in New Orleans, in L.A., in New York. So in times, poetry, you know, you're more drawn to it.
Yeah.
But places, no, not so much, you know.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So I know L.A., I wasn't drawn to L.A. for poetry. I'm not an actor or somebody that's like, you know, combing the Hollywood Hills for agents or doing, what do you call those things? I don't know, interviews and go-sees. I don't do that stuff.
Right.
I just haven't, you know.
Uh-huh.
So that's not why I'm there,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
you know. But it's a really relaxed situation for now.
Yeah,
it's a good time. I live by the beach.
Uh-huh.
It's pretty mellow.
Yeah,
pretty laid back.
Yeah,
I don't know. Maybe I'll be back. Maybe I'll move back to the East Coast. Maybe I'll move back to Jersey. I don't know. But for now, it's a good respite.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've given this person much thought in your life, one way or the other. It's someone that I have such admiration for. And as a spoken word person, I'm gonna find out if you've given her much thought. You'll tell me. And if you have given her any thought, you'll tell me what those thoughts were. Nikki Giovanni.
I like her work. I would say not to make things comparisons, but she came out of the Black Arts Movement at the same time that Sonia Sanchez did. Mm-hmm. I would say that Sonia Sanchez's work perhaps gravitates toward to me more, and it's kind of like Thelonious Monk and Miles Davis. I don't know, that would be that, those aren't perfect contemporaries. So let's say Thelonious Monk and Dizzy.
Yeah.
Even Dizzy stuff, like the bebop, you know, is darker. Uh-huh. You know, Thelonious Monk stuff is slick, because you know it as soon as you know that's him.
Yeah.
And it's the same way. So like, Sonia Sanchez's work is darker.
Yeah, and I love hearing what you're saying right now. And I want to know, you say it gravitates towards you more. Why?
Because it's darker. I like the bluesy stuff. I like, if it's jazz, I like hard bop jazz, you know? Mm-hmm. I like Oliver Nelson and Lee Morgan and Wayne Shorter and Herbie and Art Blakey, you know? I like the whole hard bop period, the period where Miles Davis and Coltrane worked together and did the kind of blue. Mm-hmm. I like that period, the dark stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. So like a lot of like what Mingus did, you know, and a lot of what Thelonious Monk did, I like it. And even Charlie Parker, like the stuff was like brighter.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how I make that comparison, where Nikki Giovanni's stuff is brighter. It tends to be brighter. Sonia Sanchez's stuff tends to be darker. Mm-hmm. And I just gravitate towards darker things, towards the more bluesy stuff.
Did you see the Miles Davis movie?
No, I will though, because it's on demand now, so I'll check it out. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay, all right. Yeah. Okay, you didn't see it, because I had to have you back on. Just to talk about that, because I can imagine that you will have a lot to say about it.
I probably would. I've read a great deal about him. I've heard firsthand accounts from people that he knew. Mm-hmm. Same thing with like Nina Simone. So I collect that type of information because I think it's informing.
Yeah. You did a piece called Organized.
Organized, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'll ask you about it after we run it. Let's take a look.
These here times is different. In these times, if you're a young black chick, I'll call you in the middle of the night. You might want to wake that up, get dressed, and go get him. Otherwise, you may have just spoken to the next law enforcement harassment victim. In these times of Black Lives Matter, where the souls of black folks are scattered with the dreams and hopes of dusky mothers and grandmothers who themselves could become the next Eleanor Bumpers with them two shotgun blasts, and alas, if your gifted and talented honor roll student, great candidate for scholarships, finds herself in the crosshairs of the wrong cop, look, moms and pops, I'm not sure her exemplary demeanor or her stellar report card will be able to get her out of it. Nah, she might as well have on that limited edition Eazy-E the police t-shirt with that red, black, and green jacket and blazing on the back. Red, black, and green jacket and blazing on the back with Sandra Bland smoking a cigarette, holding up the middle finger on both hands. It's like the cops creep up to your child wearing a sick smile, listening to their favorite slow jam. The program ain't changed from Oscar Grant to Freddie Gray with that din-a-din, din-a-din. And still Freddie's dead, even though we've been cutting 12 inches that represent the 12 bullets that was put into little Bobby Hutton, because ain't nothing new under the sun. It's just these days the phrase Black Lives Matter has become a rallying cry for cops, some of whom believe they can't justify their self-worth unless they prove Black Lives Matter. Not got a Mike Brown, hands up, man down, cover up. Black Lives Matter, and immediately before and after death, some of us get to hang out at the bar with Sean Bell. We get to sip shots of Flint, Michigan water and smoke cartons of Eric Garner cigarettes. Ain't no true right of action for black men and black women whose very names have been reduced to action words. In other words, they will snatch you out of that Bentley, Benz, or Beamer, and your upwardly mobile ass will commence to getting the Allowed King or Loema. They got euthanasia tasers, beat them silly billy clubs and kill the trigger fingers. The thing is, they on that Laquan McDonald skag. They addicted to them black bodies and black body bags. Got them nodding off, got them tapping that arm and put them in the zone. They could die in their sleep. They on that Ayanna Monet, Stanley Jones. It's coming down. Cue the last poets. Jones coming down. Daybreak, Jones coming down. Got the shakes, Jones coming down. nose running, joint dripping, mind slipping, body aches. They say it's impossible to convince a man that what he's doing is evil when his very livelihood depends on him doing it. They say if I bring up the need to address black on black murder within the context of Black Lives Matter, that would just take a perfectly myopic solution to our situation and ruin it. But perhaps they'd at least allow me to address the number of judges that get kickbacks from moving more and more black bodies into the privately run prison industrial complex with that order in the court. You were guilty when you got here. You were guilty. You were guilty when my family wanted to be treated to vacations. You were guilty. I hope you brought a toothbrush. You were guilty when my children's college education became too difficult to pay for. Now back to our regularly scheduled program. Let's pray for Black Lives Matter, and let's pray for those cops who are not intimidated by the very idea of Black Lives Mattering, and let's pray for the most at-risk, vulnerable, and endangered lives. And then,
when we finish praying, let's practice self-defense,
self-determination, self-love, and organize.
You said something in there, it's difficult to convince someone
that what they're doing is evil.
That what they're doing is evil
when their life depends on it.
Depends on what they're doing.
Yeah.
Where'd that come from?
It's I didn't create it. It's something that I've always heard. So it's kind of like if you were working for this current president, right, and that's where your money was coming from, mm-hmm. then it's hard to convince that person, mm-hmm. you know, that's getting paid for doing the bidding, mm-hmm. that what they're doing is evil. Mm-hmm. They have to believe that it's right because otherwise they feel like they're not going to eat. So mm-hmm. they convince themselves. So that mm-hmm. it was a.
So that's a form.
So just in terms of like police, you know, in terms of police officers, yeah. You know, looking the other way sometimes is like, you know, that's just a natural thing because that's how they make their money and that's their livelihood.
And whether that's a police officer or a person working for Donald Trump.
I don't even like to say the dude's name, but yeah.
Neither do I. Well, I'm not supposed to say
not at this point.
Working for the president or a drug dealer or a gangbanger.
Right.
It's all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's all. You have to practice self-delusion.
Exactly. Exactly. All of that.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yep. You were strong there in repeating Black Lives Matter. And your reaction to those that respond to that by saying all lives matter.
Yeah, I mean the all lives matter thing is just it's a way to diffuse the significance. It's like, you know, if your house is on fire, you know, and you're telling people to help you put out your house, and somebody runs up and says, "Well, hold up, all houses matter." It's like, but your house is the one that's on fire, mm-hmm. you know. So that's just put there to confuse an issue, and it's sad. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a comedian from Saturday Night Live that was mentioned, a guy named Che, was saying, like, you know, and the slogan only says, the motto only says matters. Mm-hmm. It doesn't say, you know, black lives are more important than everybody else. It just, yeah. just they matter.
Yeah.
And even that is met with resistance.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think, as you say, even that is met with resistance? What's going on?
Well, I have a love of black people. I was raised that way. I was raised in a household in which, you know, black history was, you know, throughout it. You know, my crib, my nursery was red, black, and green when I was a kid. Yeah. I went to the Chad School, which was a school that was put together by black people for black people, yeah. and we learned black history from the time we were in kindergarten. Yeah. So I'm partial.
Yeah.
Okay. And I happen to be black.
And
you know, and I like to say black instead of African American. Just for the record, because when I say black, it makes the connection between all the black people mm-hmm. around the globe. Mm-hmm. African American only, you know, points out the, you know, the 10, mm-hmm. you know, the 40 million mm-hmm. black people who happen to live here. Mm-hmm. But I like to point out black because there are a billion plus black people around the globe. Mm-hmm. So that's why I stick with black.
Yeah, and I love your answer, even though I don't think you understood my question.
Okay.
The question was, when folks say all lives matter, and primarily what I'm talking about there is our reactionary white brothers and sisters say, well, yeah, but all lives matter. Why do you think they need to say that?
I've learned to say I don't know when I don't know, mm-hmm. but I will tell you that I believe that all lives matter. I mean, yeah, that I don't disagree, mm-hmm. but it's far from the point of our message right now. Mm-hmm. Our message is about stopping a wrong, correcting a pseudo genocide, if not, you know, all out genocide. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a separate issue. Of course, everyone matters, mm-hmm. but that abstracts the point of what's going on right now.
Yeah. You are very much concerned about the erosion of education with black kids.
Certainly. Yeah. Anyone will tell you, right, in education at this point, that there needs to be a stronger focus on STEM education, right? Science, mm-hmm. technology, right? Mm-hmm. Engineering, math. There needs to be a focus on, I mean, in this world of social media, of big data analytics, mm-hmm. you know, of mobile internet, you know, mm-hmm. and of clouds. Those are the things that black youth need to be pointed towards, because those are the things of the future. Automation is gonna be a thing of the future. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you can go into Wawa's and order a sandwich without talking to anyone, how long before that's gonna be common with all of the fast food chains, you know? Mm-hmm. So don't learn, you know, don't push your young children in the direction of making sandwiches. Push them in the direction of fixing the machines or creating the software and applications that, you know, allow people to order these sandwiches or to do these things. Mm-hmm. Point them in the direction of what's about to happen, of automation, of social media, of big data analytics, of mm-hmm. cloud, mobile, yeah.
Mm-hmm. How old did you say your son was?
14.
Your son is 14,
yeah.
So, you know, he's in a very precarious age group. He's in a very precarious time where parents are very fearful. What are your messages to him as he's growing through this period right now?
It's a couple of things. One of the bigger problems I've noticed with young men in general is that if they don't have a father figure in the house, they tend to think that, you know, they tend to try to come up with their own definition of what strength is. Mm-hmm. And they think that strength is in raising your voice, losing your temper, displaying violence. Mm-hmm. And the truth is, as you already know, because, you know, that's how we don't even get to be of a certain age unless we figure out that that's not what strength is. Strength is actually an opposite. Mm-hmm. So a lot of my message to my son is in the example of being patient, mm-hmm. and of listening, and of not being, you know, violent, not raising my voice, flying off the handle at every little thing, mm-hmm. you know, showing him, demonstrating to him that when faced with a challenge, you think it through. Mm-hmm. You don't react, you respond, mm-hmm. you know? And I would think that might be the bigger lesson to that one, and him seeing, you know, someone be responsible, mm-hmm. and consistent. Mm-hmm.
And so, are you hopeful?
For who?
Are you?
You got to be specific.
Yeah.
Some
okay.
things I'm not hopeful about
yeah,
at all.
Okay. Okay. Would you choose to have another child?
No.
Now?
No.
Why?
But it's not about the time. I'm done with that.
Okay. It's not the circumstances and the situation that's going on in the world. That's just you.
If I didn't have any children, I would have a child now.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And I probably would be even more proactive in raising that child. See, my son didn't always live with me. So mm-hmm. that's the other thing. He's mm-hmm. only lived with me for about 3 years now.
Uh-huh.
You know, and that had been the agreement from the time he was born, that at a certain age he'd have a rite of passage where he would move in with his father. So he's been with me for about 3 years.
Uh-huh.
I don't think that would be a good good paradigm these days. I would definitely want to be with that child from the beginning.
Uh-huh.
I would have another child. I would have a child if I didn't have one.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that I'm done.
Yeah,
having children.
I mean, I asked the question, man, and that was a serious question, because I just recently had some serious conversation, and about 7 people were in this conversation, and 4 of them, it was a mixed group, men and women, and 4 in the group that they would not want to bring a child into today's conditions.
I suppose, man, but it's a vicious cycle.
Mm-hmm.
Number one. Number two, you know, they talk about people who get married, you know, and they tend to remarry after they get divorced, because they say marrying people marry. And then I know I have friends who've never been married, and they probably never will be. And the same thing with having children. I think there are people who are who have a leaning toward that. I'm one of those people. I am somebody who would probably lack a great deal of motivation if I didn't have children. You know what I mean? They're a large, my children are a large part of the reason it's even worthwhile to do half the stuff that I do. Otherwise, I don't know if I'd see the point of much.
So you could see yourself, and this is real candor here. You could see yourself, if you didn't have the kids, being lazy.
Being reckless. I mean, they're a big part of
much
my
less
reason.
Responsible.
I mean, obviously, if you're being responsible for kids, that makes you more responsible than you would be if you didn't have kids. But I don't mean like I would be like some type of derelict. I just mean that I draw inspiration and encouragement and joy. I mean, they can get on my nerves, you know. But my biggest source of joy is the children. You know, my biggest source of accomplishment are really their accomplishments. You know, the vicarious living. You take that away, I would lose a lot of interest in what's happening in this world.
You know, we have about 15 minutes left, and I'm just really torn between, you know, continuing some conversation, because on the one hand, I'm feeling what you're saying. I think, you know, our audience would be very much enjoying what you're saying.
Just contextually, do you have children?
I have two stepkids, and I have grandchildren.
Right, and I have four. I have four stepchildren too. Yeah, so I have seven.
Right.
When you put it all together. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, so I understand. I mean, I definitely feel what you're saying. I think I'd like to take the liberty here of doing something that I've never really done.
You gonna do a poem?
This is the legend of Cassius Clay, the most beautiful fighter of the world today. He talks a great deal and brags indeed of a muscular punch that's incredibly speedy. The fistic world was dull and weary. With a champ like Liston, things had to be dreary. Then someone with color, someone with dash, brought fight fans a-running with cash. The brash young boxer is something to see, and the heavyweight championship is his destiny. The kid fights great. He's got speed and endurance. If you sign to fight him, you better raise your insurance. Ah, rumble, young man, rumble. That's about it. Now, don't ask me to go any deeper than that in the poetry world. But what I'd like for you to do maybe is take a deep breath and think about three of your pieces. And if you could go back to that camera right there. And we got a vast listening audience that can't wait to hear what you're about to say.
All right, I'll give you one that you've never heard before.
Oh, that's great.
Okay. Do not pass go. They want a monopoly over your mind, your soul, and your body. And you want to know how they go from slinging rocks to breaking rocks. The devil's in the details are key. Society will convince you to sell vows so they can sentence you to a cell, then sell your free services like vows. You really think them judges don't got contracts for kickbacks, the manifesting all in one size fit all cookie cutter trials? Nah, for them, a slave court is like Rikers Island, just a stash. And they get to re-up immediately after they tee up with their connect at the country club. So when you stand in front of that judge, you looking like money, blood. And when you find yourself standing in front of a black robe that stands to make money off your black ass, it's probably too late to ask whether you ever really should have believed that a trap house could be the way out. See, the funny thing about traps is eventually everybody gets to play the mouse. Serve fiends, serve time. Become a purveyor of free goods and services. Go from being your own man to one of the private prison industrial complexes, human purchasers, money worshippers, tend to end their story as inventory. Them cell block tiers be like shelves, and them jumpsuits and barcoded bracelets, that'd be your packaging. And this ain't the first time they stacked Africans, but perhaps one of the first times that some of us was half volunteering. Like, we prefer the company of a cellmate to that of our soulmate and our children. Pardon self, I love you, bro. You're gonna do what you're gonna do, but prior to I get to speak my piece, is each one teach one in this belly of the beast, and that crime bill should have been subtitled incarcerate as many black men as possible and make it damn near impossible for them to get released. These days, they'll get you if you waver. They'll enslave you if you're on the fence. And the next thing you'll hear is, excuse me, Rada, I represent the defense, and I believe this is the part of the trial where we just automatically ask for a plea bargain. I'm a public defender, so it makes my job easier if I just convince them that even though there's no real evidence against them, the jury will be filled with white senior citizens, housing crisis victims who would love to take it out on a black man but can't lynch him, so the next best thing is to vindictively convict him. Look, listen, bruh, keep your head up. earn a skill. We all fed up. But what's real is there ain't no easy way. You either stay out here and grind with the rest of us, or you chase that trap and be a slave. So that's
you,
one.
You are obviously blessed with tremendous talent.
Well, thank you.
What do you feel your responsibility is to do with that talent?
They say that, remember they said youth is wasted on the young, and other people counter it with sometimes they believe that wisdom is wasted on the old. So we know what youth is wasted on the young means, you know, because if we were younger, we would do things differently.
Yeah.
But wisdom is wasted on the old means that we get older and we learn all these lessons, but we can't help the young people because they don't want to hear it, you know? So I think part of the role of a spoken word artist as we mature is to find ways to codify what we know and give it to people, you know, some of whom will be younger than us, or some of whom will have not had the experiences that we had, in a way that makes it interesting for them to take it in and to digest it and to break it down in such a way that it just feels natural to them, you know?
I am very curious about your thoughts and opinion about Barack Hussein Obama having been the first black president and what it all meant.
I have a lot of mixed feelings about the whole office of the presidency in and of itself. Mm-hmm. You know, to be honest, I just don't understand it. It's a very complex job, mm-hmm. you know. And you wonder, because so many people die at the hands of presidents, no matter which president you're talking about, you know. And then this president had a particularly distinguished record because of the drone strikes, because of the bases in Africa and the things that were going on in Africa during his
tenure.
When
you say this president, you're talking about Obama.
Oh, I'm talking about, you know, Obama.
Mm-hmm.
And the question I just have to keep asking myself is, all right, so presidents have to see a lot of potentially good things and oversee a lot of potentially bad things. I guess the question I keep asking myself is it better really to take that office and know that at least under your watch, more progress would be made than it would have been under someone else's, mm-hmm. you know? Because I mean, obviously comparing the new president to the old president, you're like, wow. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it was on Saturday Night Live, they're talking about, you know, that this guy's making Bush look good, you know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
You know?
Right.
So looking back in retrospect, I loved the idea that youth and black youth in particular got to see a black man in that office because, you know, as Malcolm X and tons of other people would tell you, mm-hmm. you know, we have been told for so long that that's something that you'd never be. Malcolm X said he wanted to be president, he wanted to be a lawyer. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be those things.
Mm-hmm.
So just to see it, you know, because some children now, that was all they ever knew, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He was there for 8 years. But I have mixed feelings,
yeah.
you know?
Okay.
The office itself, I mean, there's a lot of murder.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of darkness. There are a lot of policies, you know, that go on behind closed doors.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I voted against this new president for a woman who, along with her husband, pretty much introduced a whole new era of slavery
yeah.
into this country that yeah. we ignore. I mean, that yeah. crime bill,
yeah.
coupled with the private prison industrial complex together, mm-hmm. has created a situation where there are black men being stripped from their families to work for free for the rest of their lives
mm-hmm.
in a prison somewhere. And yet I had to vote for her.
Mm-hmm. How difficult was that?
I don't know. I was of the opinion prior that presidents were selected rather than elected,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
But because of what our ancestors went through
yeah.
and our elders went through to mm-hmm. get the right to vote, mm-hmm. I feel like it would be irresponsible, even though I don't necessarily believe that presidents tend to be elected,
mm-hmm.
I thought it would be irresponsible to not cast my vote anyway.
Yeah, understood.
Just in case.
Understood, and I think you feel like a whole lot of people felt.
Right.
Yeah. You know.
Didn't work though.
In your work, you often seem to have a focus on black boys.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I recently sat here and interviewed a woman who was in charge of logistics for the Women's March on Washington, mm-hmm. and it drew a million people here, and you know, fair estimates are 5 million people
worldwide.
Around the world.
Yeah.
And part of what was illuminated in that conversation is just the abject lack of equality that women continue to suffer.
Yeah.
Your thoughts on that?
I mean, I don't get it. I when I was younger, they told us that women were paid a fraction of what men were paid because they weren't considered heads of households, you know, whatever. You know, you can always come up with an excuse for something. Mm-hmm. But in this day and age, I have no idea. And I'm speaking as a person who has now 5 daughters, right? Because I have 3 stepchildren who
sure.
are my children.
Sure.
And I have 2 biological daughters. Yeah. And I cannot imagine. I mean, they impress me. You know, I'm far more impressed with their accomplishments than I have been with many of my own, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I look at things through that viewing glass.
Yeah.
You know, and I've always in all my work tried to speak to respect for women,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
that's part of respecting women.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. From your person,
right?
Yeah, yeah. There's that camera waiting for you one more time. We got 5 more minutes.
What if this is God's work? What if real poets walk the earth and live lives fit for a prophet's birth, spreading ancient wisdom like the Coptic church, and those that know what they're hearing know that they're hearing something special. And perhaps eventually a poet will be sent here just to bless you, test you in this world of lies, and if you feel your eyes cry, it'll be because they recognize that what they're seeing is the truth. And the chills up your spine to provide absolute proof that in this now, where politicians and clergy are proving themselves unworthy of your time, and television shows and music videos are proving themselves unworthy of your mind, don't be surprised to find that God is especially present in poetry dens, guiding poets' pens, and not just those men who pretend to be closer to God than you by making you ashamed of your sins when the lives that they've lived may not have been what God intends for your salvation. What if this is God's work? What if the Creator realizes that the creation isn't perfect, but only wishes for us to worship sincerely, to not be hypocrites, but to really be concerned about our fellow man, to stand up against injustices falsely perpetuated in God's name in foreign lands? What if this is God's work? What if the poets are closer to Muhammad, Buddha, and Jesus than the preachers? I said, what if the poets are closer to Muhammad, Buddha, and Jesus than the preachers? I mean, think about it, y'all. Which of us are living closer to the streets, and which of us are living closer to Caesar? Which of us are living high up on the hog, and which of us are the poor righteous teachers? What if this is God's work? And if so, then poetry is sacred. So ye poets be concerned, would you step up on this stage with and be on your job? Because if this is God's work, then stealing from another poet is the same thing as stealing from God. And it's not about your use of sexuality or profanity. It's about whether you use your tools for ahs and oohs, or whether you use your tools to improve humanity. What if this is God's work? And I know blasphemers have hell to pay, so I wouldn't say anything on the Rock Newman Show that I wouldn't be comfortable repeating on Judgment Day. What if this is God's work, y'all? Let us pray.
Wowzer. What do you want to do going forward? What are your dreams, man?
I want to push the envelope. I want to make to blaze a trail for other spoken word artists. We have some shows coming up in Philadelphia and in Newark on June 2nd, and in Philadelphia the next day, and Baltimore the day after that. And I'm bringing in some of my favorite poets, some of the poets that were mentioned by Kamon to me earlier, a minute ago. Mm-hmm. And I just want to blaze a trail. I felt like I never really did do the best job at that I could have, to leave something for those who are coming up afterward. Mm-hmm. You know, I think I could have done more in the past, and right now I'm trying to help blaze that trail to leave something, mm-hmm. so that everything that I did wasn't just for me, just so I could travel around the world and meet new people and have all these, mm-hmm. you know, crazy weird experiences.
Mm-hmm.
Experiences going through my head, like I remember this guy's hair catching on fire in Amsterdam. Boy, it was weird, but.
Yeah.
You know, just all these weird memories, you know, but there has to be more than that.
Yeah.
What did I leave? You know, like what it's called infrastructure, right?
Right.
You have to leave infrastructure. You have to leave something so that somebody else can follow you and build on it, and not have to just start all over again because you didn't leave the infrastructure there.
Mm-hmm. In this 90 seconds that we have left, the child that's sitting out there who has thought about being a spoken word artist, who's thought about being a poet, but hadn't quite pulled the trigger yet, you would say what?
I would say, am I saying it somewhere? I saw you point.
Oh, no.
Okay. I would say always write from, and I don't want to say write from your heart. I want to say write the things that you believe that you could say better than anyone else because you know them intimately and you care about them profoundly. So try to write those poems that you don't think anybody else could write the way that you would write it because you care about them so much and you've researched them so much and you've lived it and people will know the sincerity in what you said. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is don't rush. I would not rush your work. Mm-hmm. Let it take its time. If a poem wants to take a year, mm-hmm. let it take a year. Some mm-hmm. poems come out in a day, some poems come out in a week, some poems take a year. Let the poem take the gestation period that the poem wants to take. And in terms of being a full-time spoken word artist, I would definitely say that in this economy and in these uncertain times, mm-hmm. I would probably try to mix it up. I would do more than one thing. I would mm-hmm. not dedicate my life to just doing spoken word at the expense of not having a livelihood, yeah, you know, sure. to the side.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
I would try to mix it up.
Mm-hmm. Brother, this hour has passed by so fast. Thank
yeah,
you so
for
much
me too.
For
Thank
joining
you.
Us.
It's been an hour. Okay.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye. And God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.